Hi, I'm Dr. John Hallberg, an associate professor in the Department of Family Medicine and Community Health at the University of Minnesota Medical School. I'm also a practicing physician and the father of two teenagers. The purpose of this program is to learn how to deal effectively with one adolescent immunization. But before we show you how to do that the right way, we're going to start by showing you a few examples that are a little less than ideal. Let's take a look at the first scenario.
Kayla looks fantastic. Before you go, there are a few vaccines we give at the two-month visit. Rotavirus, Hib, polio, the second dose of hepatitis B, and the DTaP vaccine against diphtheria, tetanus, and pertussis. Also, there is one other vaccine you could consider.
What's that?
The pneumococcal vaccine. If you're interested, we could add it to the list, but it's up to you.
Of course this is silly. You know no provider would ever be so nonchalant about the pneumococcal vaccine. It's a safe, effective, life-saving immunization. But what if the patient is a preteen, and the safe, effective, life-saving immunization we're talking about is the human papillomavirus, or HPV vaccine? Is it possible that we present that one as somehow less important? Let's check in on another scenario.
Adrienne is growing well and meeting all her developmental milestones. That's great. Now, I'd like to open what might be an uncomfortable conversation.
About what?
Well, since Adrienne's a year old now, she'll soon be interacting closely with children her own age. Diseases like measles, mumps, and chickenpox are transmitted by contact with sick people.
Okay.
If she hasn't already, she will start to reach out and touch other children who, in return, will be touching her. I don't think there's anything you can do to really stop it. It's just natural. Keeping that in mind, I wanted to educate you about the vaccines that can prevent these diseases, and especially the diseases' relationships to social behaviors, so you can make a choice that's right for your child.
Well, most vaccine-preventable diseases are spread by contact with other people, but we just don't dwell on how people get infected. Yes, the HPV infections we're concerned about are transmitted through sexual activity, but we shouldn't treat the vaccine any different from the others we give. The whole point is to prevent disease, so adolescents need to be immunized before they become sexually active.
Well, I'm glad that Jack now knows that skunks don't like it when you try to cuddle them.
I do not think we need to remind him.
Just keep the wound clean, and if it starts to swell up, bring him back into the clinic, okay?
Okay.
Oh, also, if you want, we could give him a rabies vaccine. It's your call, you're the parent.
Now, you know, he's such a healthy kid. I think his body can fight it.
Frankly, I don't think he's the type to get it. He's not like those kids in other countries where they actually die from rabies. I wouldn't worry about it.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
No need for a rabies vaccine after exposure to a wild skunk? Of course that's ridiculous. And as you know, there's no type of person to get rabies, just as there's no type of person to get an HPV infection. Most Americans will be exposed to the HPV viruses that we're concerned about through sexual activity, and 22,000 of them every year will go on to develop a form of cancer that could have been prevented by the vaccine. It's well documented that a healthcare professional's recommendation is the single most important factor in a parent accepting the HPV vaccine for their child. We just need to be calm and upfront about letting them know how important it is to receive it.
I told you, this hockey is just not a good idea. Well.
Oh, so that's going to be sore for a few days, but it should get better by the end of the week. Let us know if it doesn't, okay? All right. Now, I see that you turned 12, so since you're here, this would be a great time for those vaccines which are recommended at this age, which are HPV, Tdap, meningococcal. Are there any questions about that?
Yeah, the HPV, that seems like something that could wait until she's a little older, don't you think?
I think I get your drift, and I know it seems kind of soon, but the thing is, the vaccine are recommended at the youngest age, for which they've been proven safe and effective. No matter what the disease, you want to make sure that immunity is in place before the exposure happens. A bonus is that at Isabella's age, kids respond much more vigorously to the vaccine than older kids and adults, and that might make even better protection. It's also convenient because, well, there are two other vaccines due at the same age, and, well, those two and the first dose of HPV can all be given at the same appointment.
Okay, but I just wonder what we might be opening the door to.
Okay. Some people have had that worry. And there's research been done that has studied that question, and they found no more sexual activity among girls that have had that vaccine compared to those that hadn't. So that may have eased some minds, especially considering what you get in exchange. I think it's pretty amazing that there's a safe and effective way of preventing cancer. I'd feel a lot better if we got her protected today.
Okay.
All right, Brady, I think the doctor is going to want to do a throat culture on you, so I'll bring back a tray of supplies for that. Also, looking at your chart, it looks like you're due for some vaccines. Tdap, meningococcal, and HPV. We have some vaccine information statements that you'll want to read, but do you have any questions?
I hate to see him get three shots at once, and I've read that the HPV vaccination doesn't necessarily prevent all types of HPV, so I think we'll just skip that one.
It's true that there are many different types of HPV, so it's great that you're aware of that. We're really happy that the vaccine we use in this office protects against two cancer-causing types of HPV and two types that cause genital warts. We actually had a continuing education service on this and learned that the four types of HPV the vaccine prevents are responsible for, by far, the biggest share of a whole variety of cancers, including anal cancer in men. Plus, they also account for 90% of genital warts, and the vaccine's nearly 100% effective against those four virus types, so it really does knock out a lot of the health threats from HPV. And there's no evidence that the vaccine wears off even years after you've had it.
So you'd recommend it pretty strongly then?
I do. The pediatricians and the family doctors in our office do. And actually the oncologists here in town, those are the cancer specialists, are big fans of the HPV vaccine. The cancer doctors in particular would love to have fewer patients coming to them who could have avoided cancer if they'd had the HPV vaccine.
Well, it looks like you're getting that shot.
Totally okay with that.
Okay, everything looks great, and you can pick up your forms for the soccer tryouts on your way out. I noticed in your chart here that we haven't given you the HPV vaccine, though. We should do that today. Do you have any questions for me before we bring your mom back in?
Well, like, we've talked about it, and I'm not having sex. When I do, it won't be the kind of person that's been around a lot. I just don't feel like I need it.
Well, it makes me really happy to know that you've made the decision to not have sex for now and see yourself being careful about it in the future. It's going to protect your health in a lot of different ways. The thing that most people don't know about HPV, though, is that it's incredibly common. It turns out that 4 out of 5 of us will have at least one HPV infection during our lives. So it's not something that just circulates in people who have a lot of partners. Almost all of us will be exposed to it sooner or later. In your case, later. The vaccine gets your natural immune processes going, so you're ready and able to fight off an infection if you are exposed in the future.
I've never heard anybody I know that has HPV.
Well, it's not exactly the kind of thing people talk about. And really, people your age wouldn't have any way to know if they did have HPV. We usually don't test for it until you're an adult. And the cancers that it causes generally don't show up for years. Now, the virus can just come and go without causing any trouble if it's the type that doesn't cause warts or cancer. And even if it is a dangerous type, sometimes the body can clear it before it can do any damage. It's just that there's no way to control which type or types you'll get, and no way to guarantee that if you do get a cancer-causing type, it'll go away on its own. I'd hate for you to count on luck when you could protect yourself by getting vaccinated. If we get the first one done today, you can schedule the next two on your way out and be done in 6 months.
Okay.
Sean, you're in great health. It's wonderful to see you making so many healthy choices. Shannon, everything looks good. The last thing we need to do today is to get you the vaccines that are recommended at this age. Meningococcal, HPV, and Tdap. I know the nurse gave you these vaccine information statements to look at before. Do either of you have any questions about the three vaccines?
Well, I'm okay with the meningococcal and the Tdap, but I've heard some bad things about the HPV, so I think we'll just skip that today.
Can you say some more about what you've heard?
Well, it's a relatively new vaccine, and I've heard that some people have had some pretty bad reactions to it, and I'm just not worried enough about HPV to take a chance that the vaccine's gonna do something bad to Sean.
I know it's been in the news a lot lately, and actually, because I've had so many questions from my patients about it, I made it a special point to really look into the safety studies behind it. Vaccines go through a lot of testing before they ever get to a doctor's office. These tests make sure that the vaccines work at preventing diseases and that they're very safe. There's also ongoing monitoring for safety all the time that they're being used with the general public. I have a chart on the wall that we can look at that explains the process in more detail, but the HPV vaccine has been recommended and licensed since 2006, and we don't have any serious safety concerns.
But I know I've heard about people fainting after getting it.
Adults and adolescents sometimes do faint after certain medical procedures, including vaccinations, so it's not specific to the HPV vaccine. In fact, we ask all big kids and adults to stay seated in the office for 15 minutes after every vaccination for that very reason. Now, I'm very comfortable with the safety of the HPV vaccine, and I do think it's important for Sean to have it today. My nieces and nephews went through the same vaccination series when they were Sean's age, and I wouldn't want anything different for him.
Well, what do you think? Okay.
We now have a way to prevent today's adolescents from developing certain forms of cancer tomorrow. And all we have to do is treat the HPV vaccine just like any other. Take every opportunity to recommend it, give the doses on schedule, and be prepared to answer any question, just as you would for any other vaccine. No drama needed.